leadership, I was proud to co-sponsor your bill that passed the House with 26 Republicans, showing the courage to address an emergency with respect to the most esteemed institution of government in America. We have an obligation constitutionally to ensure that something that's been part of the American fabric since 1775 has a future. The Postal Service is not only fighting for its economic survival, it's fighting to maintain 120 years of professional service, rid of rotten patronage systems that served elected officials and not those who rely on mail every day. We're here today to save the Postal Service. We have in front of us a newly appointed Postmaster General and the Chairman of the Board of Governors that selected him for that post. We have a PMG who, 6 weeks into the complex and awe-inspiring new job, in the midst of a global pandemic, and just weeks before a consequential national election where the Postal Service will play an unprecedented role, decides to announce a sweeping reorganization that he admits could slow down mail and will undoubtedly infuse uncertainty and confusion throughout the Postal Service and into our neighborhoods all across America. He announces these and other abysmally unsupported changes without engaging staff, unions, trade organizations, mailers, mail recipients, or Congress. In fact, Congress was told Mr. DeJoy did not yet feel prepared to respond to any questions we might have for him. Yet, he felt confident enough to freeze overtime, delay mail delivery, and announce sweeping reorganizations. And Mr. Duncan, congratulations on being the rubber stamp. The Postal Service Board of Governors is required by law to represent the public interest, not the president, not a political party, or not even the Postmaster General. Today, the Postal Service employs 650,000 people. It's the foundation for more than a $1.7 trillion mailing industry that employs another 7.5 million people. But at the turn of the last century, the U.S. Post Office was nothing more than 77,000 patronage positions rife with gross incompetence and often embezzlement of funds. It was rural America that used its political voice at that time to professionalize the post office. Instead of traveling miles to the closest general store to pick up mail from a sycophantic political hack, rural residents lobbied Congress en masse for rural free delivery, an innovation that brought mail delivery to even the most distant of homes and businesses. The massive grassroots lobby effort brought those with acumen and expertise into the post office and refocused political leaders on what they were elected to do, serve the people, not their political parties. As a nation, the people transformed the post office into the Postal Service. This history lesson resonates today. Yet another reckoning for this country and the Postal Service. Here again, the people of the nation have stood up loudly and consistently to condemn attempts to turn a crown jewel of our federal government, by far the most trusted agency among the hundreds that serve this nation, into a spoils systems honeypot. We cannot and must not let that happen. During this pandemic, the Postal Service is a lifeline to the delivery of life-saving prescription medications, medical equipment, food and pantry staples, stimulus checks to pay rent and utility bills, census forms, and even simply coupons to help struggling families stay out of poverty. What leader would think that even the possibility of slowing down mail in a time such as this is a good idea? What leader would take steps to freeze overtime for a workforce literally risking its life every day to deliver mail to the people of this nation? 40,000 postal workers have contracted COVID-19 or been quarantined because of it. 40,000. As the new PMG, Mr. DeJoy has recklessly cut hours and delayed delivery times in the pursuit of unsupported operational efficiencies. He's never once asked Congress for help, despite a team of members ready to provide financial and other support. The chairwoman and I, along with a collection of hundreds of members, have been fighting to provide the Postal Service with $75 billion in support. to pay overtime and hazard costs to the dedicated workforce, to invest in a modernized and green postal fleet that doesn't explode, to pay for information technology investments that can streamline communications from trucks and planes that are running late with important cross-county or international mail deliveries. Mr. DeJoy and Mr. Duncan have failed to work with Congress to get this enacted. Thus far, the passenger service airline industry has received $25 billion in revenue stabilization, the Postal Service, not a dime. On August 18th, the PMG announced he would put a hold on some of these sweeping operational changes, but his announcement did not commit to reversing the cuts to service and capacity already made. It did not include an agenda to support election mail that demonstrates a commitment to helping the Postal Service fulfill its historic role in the upcoming election. And lastly, the PMG is still not advocating for the additional funding for the Postal Service, despite the fact that the Republican-controlled, Trump-appointed Board of Governors unanimously called for that package. Not a Democratic idea, a Republican-dominated board unanimously recommending it. The recent operational and organizational changes Mr. Joy has made have resulted in delivery delays across the country, as the chairwoman just showed. And those aren't our data. That's yours, Mr. Postmaster General. These delays have real impacts on real lives with real consequences. Most devastatingly, they've damaged the Postal Service's credibility in a very brief time. Congratulations, Mr. DeJoy, an esteemed institution that now is in doubt in the American public's mind. I applaud my colleagues in the House for passing the Delivery for America Act bill, because we need to act now. We need to reverse this. We need to reassure the American public that they will get their mail on time and that their ballots will get there on time and be counted. This is about the future of our democratic institutions. This is the future about the most important election in my lifetime. That's what's at stake today. I yield back.